We are delighted to have Negin with us tonight. She is a woman of many talents, and she never fails to impress and entertain wherever she goes and whatever she does, whether it's stand-up comedy or writing a memoir. When Susan Call, our director of events and programs, saw an early version of Negin's film, Third Street Blackout, she said it was as charming and funny as Negin herself and was determined to bring her to D.C. to meet you all. So in her first book, Negin explores her own many hyphenated identity as an Iranian-American-Muslim and as a Panamanian-Puerto Rican-American. I can totally relate to that. Well, she delivers a sharp and funny critique of American culture and poses serious and much-needed questions about race. So please join me in welcoming Negin Farsad.
Hello. Oh, there it is. It's funny because they literally were like, are you paying attention? This is how you turn on the microphone. And I wasn't paying attention. Okay. Guys, thank you so much for showing up. I'm like so heartened that there are people in DC who give a flying fuck about what I do. So that's really nice. Also wanted to let you guys know that they sell lint rollers over there in the corner. So after you're done buying this book, you could pick up some lint rollers. And also I was like nervous about the announcement about the parenting event downstairs, because I just pictured like a horde of people just getting up and then going downstairs. And I want to just let you know, if you are here for the parenting event, I am the proud parent of a small dog. And so I have a thank you. And my number one piece of advice is the wee wee pad. And there's more gems like that if you stay. So, and this is also my first book event outside of New York City where I live. And so thank you for making it like not sad, because I really just thought I was going to be like doing a soliloquy like alone in a room. but you guys are here, so this is great. I got to tell my mom, she's really wondered about this career. I'll tell you a little bit about the book. You mentioned hyphenated identities and stuff like that, and I'm an Iranian American Muslim lady like all of you, and I this guy is really an Iranian American Muslim lady. And when you're a part of like a really, underpopulated ethnic minority, you kind of have this longing for to be a part of a thing, and you're like, I don't, where's my posse, and where's the gang, and I want to be a part of the violence. The opening chapter of the book is called I Used to Be Black, and it's because I used to be black, like not in a Rachel Dolezal way, like, but it, because I wasn't like trying to pretend, but I didn't curl my hair, but I felt black, sometimes really black, sometimes pretty black, sometimes Don Cheadle, and then on certain occasions I was just hungry, and then I ate a bag of Cheetos or something, and it cleared up my identity confusion. And it got to the point where I ended up, and it was always like this, right? Because I grew up in Palm Springs, California. Anyone here familiar with the, hey, okay, this one's for you. We moved to Palm Springs from the sticks of Virginia, and I was like the new kid at school. And it was a tough move for me, right? Because I was the new kid. I was Iranian, named Negin, and I spoke with a redneck Southern accent. And so I would cry into my mother's arms, like, "Why can't I just be blonde or Mexican like all the other kids?" And I sounded like Butters. That's how I started my life. Was sounding like Butters, and maybe arguably I still, I moved. So I'm in Palm Springs, and Palm Springs is a really weird town, right? It's like simultaneously one of the top five gay cities. It's one of the top five retirement communities in California, and so it's the kind of place where you see people, you know, dancing to Lady Gaga while adjusting their catheters or something, you know. So that's the kind of town it is, and you know, I grew up among senior citizens, like in a straight up like neighborhood of senior citizens, and so I would find myself playing, you know, in the front yard and on the in the street in front of our house alone, and there would be like a really like slow moving Cadillac just kind of like, you know, just threatening me at minimum speeds, and that was my childhood, and that's really weird. And the other main population in Palm Springs were the Mexicans. And so, you know, I said I grew up feeling black, but the only black people we had in Palm Springs were Mexicans. So I went with that. And I know that like some of this stuff feels like it's a little, you know, culturally insensitive, but I just want to remind you that there was no such thing, there was no such thing as cultural sensitivity when I was growing up. It was a lot like today. So don't worry. It's cool, and it's all satire. So the other main population were the, like I said, the Mexicans, and I longed to be Mexican because we had these, you know, Mexicans had their like their ranchero music and their restaurants, and they had icons like Cesar Chavez, and they were just a recognizable group, and the biggest part of that for me was the names, because in high school, like everyone, all of the teachers could pronounce all of the, you know, Mexican names, like ridiculously pronounce them. So they would be like, you know, Rodrigo here, like, you know, Aurelia, you know, here. And then when it got to me, they would be like Negin. And then this one time, literally this woman goes, Noodle. She goes, Noodle Farsad, and then she laughed and laughed because she thought it was so hilarious. And I'm over it, obviously. I don't need to talk about it anymore. It's something that I've already dealt with or whatever, and so we're good, we're fine. I'm totally over it. But it's funny too, because it's not even like that noodle, it's not, that's the wrong stereotype. We're a rice-based people, so I was just sort of like, why doesn't even make any sense? Okay. And then she ended up calling me NF for the rest of the semester, which again, I'm fine with. And here's the other weird thing. This particular class where the woman NF'd me all semester long, it was one of those classes where, and I don't know if you guys had this, but in my school they put sex ed and driver's ed in the same hour. Did you guys, so the class would just be like, okay, this is how you do a 3-point turnabout or whatever, and then at the middle point they'd be like, all right, and now we're gonna turn to the backseat of the car where all the fucking happens, right? And so that's what my, do you guys know there's cursing in the book also? So like, if that's weird for you, there's a parenting discussion downstairs that might be more appropriate. So I longed to be Mexican, and one of my best Mexican friends growing up, he actually later turned out to be a gay Mexican, which is a crossover category. You get 10 points for that. He would tell me these interesting tidbits about Mexican culture, and one of them was that for the turkey, like holiday dinner, instead of having the traditional turkey, what Mexican families do is they have a giant stuffed bean. Are there any Mexicans in here who can, no Mexicans in Washington, D.C. Okay, learning things today. So for those of you who don't know, what Mexican families do is they take a bean and they grow it all year long until it's as large as a turkey, right? And then they stuff that bean with rice and salsa and smaller beans, and that's what they have for their Christmas dinner. And I believed him. I went around telling every old and gay person I could find this interesting tidbit about Mexican culture until I realized that my friend was lying like a Mexican. joking. Guys, like I literally just said, some of my best friends are Mexican. Okay, so that's what every racist asshole says. All right, no, okay. It's confusing. She is xenophobe? We don't know. All right. So anyways, I graduate from high school, and then I move to, I go to college in upstate New York, and there were just no Mexicans as far as the eye could see, you know, and I felt comfortable around them, and I was like, what do I do? And because again, like when you're a part of a severely underpopulated ethnic minority, where are my Filipino Americans at? Where are my Indian Americans at? Where are my Romanian Americans at? When you're part of these groups, you just don't know where to, because you're like, you're watching an episode of Friends and that doesn't really work, and then you're watching an episode of, you know, the Cosby Show. Oh, that's not a good reference because of the rape. Okay, but anyway, you get my point. You're not, that doesn't really quite, but you know, so when you, so you're looking at these groups and you're just sort of like, they're not my group, but close enough, you know? So you kind of adopt this thing, and then you know, you glom onto those groups to feel sort of like some kind of belonging. So in college, I arrive there, and I was like, okay, this is just a shitload of white people. All right, you know, and that is not, Southern California is very diverse. So I was like, all right, well, let me see if I could just try and be like white. Is that, can I pat, is that something I could do? And so I tried that for a second, and it just turns out there's just far too much Dave Matthews involved in being a white person and in a lot of like monogrammed backpacks and stuff. So I just couldn't do that. But and plus, you know, you're not, you can't opt in, you know, to whiteness. That's kind of, it's rewarded. So, and I don't, you know, they do it at frat parties. It's a really elaborate procedure. So that was not an option for me, and that's when like my black formation really began. I started like studying the canon of cinema and of black cinema, and I started just casually saying in conversation things like, "You better chickity check yourself before you wreck yourself." Like I was ridiculous and stupid, and then I ended up getting like most comedians, I ended up getting a master's degree in African American studies. And I was the only, you know, non-black person in the group, you know. And I was just like, where are all the other Iranian ladies? What is happening here? But anyway, and they were just sort of, I mean, very lovely. And this is at Columbia. That's dropping the Ivy League name bomb there. There you go. I'm really smart is what I'm trying to tell you. I have to tell you, because otherwise you're just going to think I'm xenophobe from everything that I'm saying that's confusing. But anyway, like I said, I'm really smart. I was at Columbia. All right. And like, I'm really dumb. Okay. And so what happened was, and people were really nice, and it was really rigorous work, and it was great. And I paired it with a master's degree in public policy, which is, you know, as you know, a requirement for comedians. And I people were just like, you know, don't you have your own people? You know, what are you doing here? And I would be like, yeah, I mean, how could you say that? I will fight for African American rights whenever and wherever. Like, I have the DVD box set of A Different World in my backpack. Like, I am about to change my name to Tyler Perry Presents Negin Farsad. And they were like, yeah, like, it's weird that you would do all of those things. And that sort of, and it wasn't that moment, but over time, I sort of also realized that I could have a voice for my own people, And because also this was in the aftermath of 9/11, so there were, Muslims were on the map in a real bad way, and part of the problem was that I just didn't identify, you know, with any of the kind of icons that were available to me. It was stuff like, you know, dusty dudes roaming the desert with AK-47s, and then ladies with the black shrouds that just sort of floated, and uranium, and I just enriched some uranium back there. I don't know if you can smell it. It smells like bacon. And it's Iranians are just, they can't stop enriching uranium. We're so cliche that way. it's so funny because it got so bad at a certain point with the uranium enrichment. People would be like, "Hey, Negin, you want to hang out later?" That is, if you're not, you know, busy enriching uranium. I'd be like, I live in a typically small Manhattan apartment, so I don't have enough room for where would I keep a particle accelerator? You know what I mean? I don't even have enough room for my minorly evil Cambodian child trafficking ring. Never mind my totally evil plans of global nuclear domination. Anyways, it's a matter of real estate is what I'm saying. So Donald Trump has the real estate. Okay. Yeah, she fucking said it. So what's my point? My point is I started just being like, I just started going full Muzz. You know what I mean? At that point, I was like, the Muzzy's needed. I'm here. I tried to be an adult. I fucking bought a pantsuit and I was a policy advisor for a while. Anyways, the draw of comedy. And I would go to city council meetings and be like, here are our numbers for things. And then I would do stand up and where I made fun of city council meetings. And so at a certain point, it got deeply inappropriate. And so, and then they, you know, and that was over. So I became a comedian. But in order to, and these are some of the things I, talk about in the book, and in order to make comedy a little less narcissistic and self-serving, because the jobs I kind of got early on really made me want to kill myself. I wrote, let's keep it in the room, but I wrote just the 100 of us or whatever. I wrote for places like MTV and Nickelodeon, where I would generate 45 jokes a day on Justin Bieber, exclusively. And I was like, it's gotta be better than this. I gotta do something in term that serves the world. And so that's where I sort of cooked up social justice comedy, where I can do things comedically that have a socially conscious bent to them. And so one of those things I'll mention to you guys quickly. How are we doing on time? I am just yammering. Okay. Okay. It's weird. I guess you guys, I am the one that's supposed to talk the most. So I keep forgetting. But So basically, what I did was I rounded up a bunch of Muslim American comedians in a nonviolent way, and we went on the road to places like Alabama and Mississippi and Tennessee and Arizona, places where they love the Muzzies, and we called the tour "The Muslims Are Coming," which was very confusing for some audience members who thought they were coming to some kind of preventative warning lecture on the coming Muslim apocalypse. You know what I mean? They'd show up and they just put away your barrels of grain. Okay, is that a magazine for some sort of rifle? No. We did the. And by the way, in the course of making doing that tour, which turned into a movie that stars some famous people in it, like Jon Stewart and Lewis Black and Jean Garofalo and David Cross, whatever, it's available on iTunes. I'm not here to promote. In the course of doing that, actually, I shot a gun for the first time. Has anyone in here shot a gun before? Okay, all right. This is a far more violent audience than I had anticipated. I'm just going to make note of that for when shit gets real. But I shot a gun for the first time, and what they don't tell you is that the casing flies back at your face with the heat of 1,000 suns. Like, nobody mentions that, right? So with me, like, I shoot the gun, and then the casing flies back at my face, and then it lands right in my cleavage, right? And immediately, I just thought, oh my God, I just shot off one of my tits. I'm gonna be lopsided for the rest of my life. They're gonna call me the Hunchback of Boober Dame. Nobody's gonna want a motorboat, a half wreck. This is a disaster. Because you really can't if you think about it. And that is imagery I will leave you with. But anyways, it turns out I just burned my skin a little bit. Everything's fine. And these are both real, guys. Okay. All right. You can, during the signing, we'll do a testing. Okay. So I talk about the Muslims are coming in the book and some of the shenanigans that ensued. But one of the little things that I did want to pull out from that was that when the movie comes out, whatever, and then it goes on Netflix, and then we start, okay, so we're promoting, and around this time, an anti-Muslim group decides to spend $300,000 on an anti-Muslim poster campaign in the New York City subway system, and I thought, that's heinous, and the ads were like really gross and offensive, and also poorly designed because bigots just have a terrible sense of aesthetic. So what I decided to do was, why not put up our own posters that say delightful things about Muslims while promoting the movie? So we worked with the MTA for over 5 months, right? They scrutinized every little detail of this poster campaign. So, like, you know, we couldn't use words like poop or genitals, and that cut out like half of our material. But we worked with them. We did everything they asked us to, and then they approved the posters. And then 2 days after the posters were supposed to go up, the MTA decided to ban the poster, citing political content. And in the poster, I mean, here's a couple of examples of what the poster, like, one of the posters says, facts about Muslims. Fact, Muslims invented the concept of a hospital. Fact, grown-up Muslims can do more push-ups than baby Muslims. Fact, Muslims invented Justin Timberlake. Another poster said the ugly truth about Muslims. They have great frittata recipes. So either frittatas were deeply political for the MTA, or the mere mention of the word Muslims was considered political. And so we didn't, you know, we sat on our haunches for a second and decided, okay, so this is where we sue them. And I don't know, anyone in here ever sue a major state agency? Oh, no? Okay, I have. And it is, it's really, it was like a year and a half long rectal exam is how I would describe that. Really long and annoying, but ultimately, we won that case. So the dirtbag comedian, thank you. I feel like I somehow subtly guilted you into that applause, but I'll take it, you know? I'm fucking writing it into my diary tonight. So that's the kind of kinds of things that I've like tried to do with social justice comedy to like enhance some of my Justin Bieber joke writing efforts. Let me see. I talk about also in the book dating. And I'll just say a couple of personal things here, which is, I have a new man in my life. Thank you. There's like two people who gave a shit, and then the rest of you were like, oh. I have a new man in my life, and he's like a marked improvement from the last man in my life, because the last guy was... ladies, have you ever dated a man who's skinnier than you? Has anyone ever? Okay, there's a couple of yeses in a room full of liars. Okay, because we've all dated a man who's skinnier than, And so let me tell you what happens. Like, what happens when you're dating like a regular sized man is that you go out, whatever, and then you go back to his place, and then the next morning you wake up and you like put on his clothes, and then you know, and you're just like, oh my god, I'm like wearing your shirt, but it's so oversized on me. I don't even know. I'm just adorable, and I'm making scrambled eggs. I'm cute, and that's just kind of what happens. But when you're dating a guy that's skinnier than you, that's less of an option, right? And so, like, I would go over to this guy's place, and then he would be like, I don't know, you want to borrow some shorts or something? And I'd be like, oh, no, thank you. This, like, black leather dress from last night is perfectly comfortable. Let's just do the crossword, you know? And it was like worse, like I felt like really bad when we went out in public and people would see us. I just felt like there was always a woman would look at us and say, oh, look at that nice young man taking his hippopotamus out for a walk. How delightful. And then you would zoom into our conversation and he would be like, honey, where do you want to go for breakfast? And I would be like, I don't know. I just want Eggs Benedict. Goosh, goosh. And they would be craters where my feet would go, and I would rip a building out of the ground and take a bite out of it, because that is what it feels like when you're dating a man who's skinnier than you. So anyway, thank you. Anyways, that didn't work, that relationship. And again, I'm over him as well, and I don't even know why you guys keep making me talk about him. But anyway, because it's fine. I do have a new man, and I feel like for a lot of my dating life, I dated a lot of, you know, white guys, and like it just felt like I wasn't trying hard enough. And no offense, you know, you're lovely. But I would, you know what I mean? You look married, but I'm just saying. And so, it just feels like I could have some kind of really exotic pairing, you know what I mean? Like me and like a Jamaican Irish guy who's drunk all the time or something, you know? I have finally landed a dude. He's African American with a smattering of Polish. Thank you. And yeah, no, I know. Well, you take a look at that kielbasa, right? I'm so stupid. I've never said that. I've never said that out loud. I'm really embarrassed for myself. Nobody's got a great kielbasa. Not to say that he doesn't have one, a great kielbasa. He has a great kielbasa, but also I've never said that out loud. Let's stop talking about it. Okay. What is my point? And you know, it's interesting because my parents, like, they're Iranian, right? if you haven't been fucking paying attention, they're Iranian. And anyone in here, children of immigrants? Children of immigrants? Yeah, okay. So you guys know, like, this is a classroom. They're putting up their hands. All right. I know. It's also not a comedy club. So anyway, I get it. But my parents can be a touch racist. I think a lot of immigrant parents can be a touch racist. And so, you know, like, my mom will say something like, oh, you know, Negin, we have a new accountant. He is Indian, but that is okay because of his money. He is like a Jew, you know? So it's just kind of like that kind of, I don't know, compliment, but also insult. I don't know what that is. And so, and I was worried about introducing my boyfriend to them and being like, oh, he's black. I don't know. And, you know, of course, they had their kind of like requisite 5 minutes of racism where they're like, we don't have a problem with black people, but, you know, and that kind of thing. And which is like no one who says that is standing on firm rhetorical ground. But I just thought, you know, and then they totally got over it because they met him and he's great and like now they like prefer him to me. It's cool. I always thought like, what is this? There's this thing, it's generational, right? Like some of these bigoted things are just gonna like die off, you know? And it's inevitable that my generation is gonna have some stupid thing that we hold on to, and then the younger generation, you know, cause I don't know what it's gonna be like 20 years from now. now, my son will walk through the door and he'll be like, you know, Mom, I'm a skull humper or something like that. And I'll be like, oh my God, why are you a skull humper? Oh, I can't handle it. You know, and he's like, Mom, God, shut up. It's like totally legal in every state. Like, it's totally accepted. Like, what are you talking about? Mom, shut up, God, you know? And then I'll be like, all I want is for my son to be like, Phyllis's son, okay, Phyllis's son, he just married a nice goat cyborg just like everybody else, okay? And all I want to be able to do is walk, you know, go to my son's hologram wedding, okay? And then walk his avatar down the aisle, and then what are you going to do? You're going to hump a skull? I don't even know how that works. And what I really like about this future scenario is that I turn into a Jewish grandmother, because all Muslim women turn into Jewish grandmothers. That's what happens. Someone tell John Kerry. I will tell you this. I gotta wrap up here. So I could take your questions, and then I guilt you into book purchases, which we're gonna allot 20 minutes for that guilt session. I had to go back to California, you know, not too long ago, because my aunt was visiting from Iran, and you know, and she had never been to this country before. And I said to my mom, "Oh my God, like she's never been here. Like we have to take her out, you know." And this is California, right? So I was like, "We have to take her out to eat a taco, you know." And she was like, "Oh, that is a good idea, but how is taste taco?" And I was like, "Lady, like you've been living here for over 30 fucking years, and you don't know how is taste taco?" And she was like, no. And I was so mad. And I was like, you fucking immigrants come to this country and you don't eat Mexican food? It's un-American. But I will tell you that I have gone to Iran before. I had to go there because I had a cousin who was getting married. And even though we were like, you know, the same age, I didn't know if I should hide all the freedoms I enjoy, like if I should censor myself around her, you know, hide from her stuff like boys and alcohol and peaceable assembly, you know, which is really fun. And because I felt like if she knew the truth about me, she'd consider me some kind of Iranian-American slut whore hooker prostitute, you know, which in New York we just call a Facebook friend. So I go to Iran, and I'm at my aunt's house, and you know, I had to take a piss, as I am known to do, even in the United States. And I asked my aunt where the bathroom was, and she says with pride, "Negin, we have an American toilet for you here." And I was really excited because I had spent a fair amount of time like standing over those hole in the ground Ottoman style toilets that feel like you're doing a CrossFit workout. And so this was gonna be like an elaborate vacation for my crotch muscles. And so she shows me up to the bathroom and she says, "Negin, this is the American toilet. Now you can use if you want, but it is not natural to be sitting this way. That is why Americans have so many digestive problems. You know, your cousin, she has been using Iranian toilet whole her life, and now she is getting married." And so I decide to stick with the American toilet, even though I was gonna ruin my body and be alone forever. And so I pull down my pants, I take a seat, and I'm sitting there for like alligator one, alligator two, or Mississippi one, Mississippi two. I don't wanna be divisive here. Sitting there for a couple of seconds when all of a sudden, the toilet cracks open in half. So what I'm telling you guys is I sat on a toilet, and as a result of me sitting on that fucking toilet, the toilet, the porcelain of the toilet, cracks open in half. This isn't one of those cute stories where I'm like, oh my God, I broke the toilet, as in the flush is slightly not working, but I'm still really cute. I am not cute in this story because I sat on a toilet, and the toilet cracked open, wide open in half. Let me just try to explain this to you guys in a language that you'll understand. You guys live in a world where you go to the bathroom and it's a safe space, right? It's a safe space. You're gonna feel better when you leave that bathroom than when you went in there. I don't live in that world anymore, do you understand? Because I sat on a toilet and the toilet cracked open in half. So anyways, I find myself against the bathroom tile with a bunch of toilet water and some urine, my urine, thank you. And I feel like the symbolism was clear. I was trying to impose my Western standards, and in response, Iran was crumbling beneath my ass. Guys, thank you so much. You guys are so delightful. I'm going to open it up to questions. If you guys have any, questions, let's hear them. And there's someone with a microphone, right? There's two mics. Oh, here they are. This one, and I don't know where that second one is. Oh, there it is. Okay, there it is. You want to come up? I think you're supposed to, like, have to, by law, come to the mic because of some recording situation. So we are just going to wait for this lady to walk up to the mic. Okay, here we go.
Thanks very much. Read and really very much enjoyed your book.
Oh, wow, that's only been out a week. Holy shit, okay.
Nerd. One thing that you say in your book that I found really interesting is that, and you also say it in your movie, just in case anyone hasn't gotten to the book yet, is that Catholics are never asked to renounce pedophilia.
Yeah.
As a Catholic, as someone who was educated in the Catholic school, I found that not to be my experience.
Oh, got you.
A lot of times asked to renounce pedophilia, and even to say, what's in place to make sure this can't happen?
How does that make you feel?
Fine. I think we owe everyone that explanation. But I wondered, since you mentioned it, and since I had been working in the Catholic Higher Education Institution when this all kind of broke, do you think that people shouldn't be asked? And that even asking is problematic? Or that we should eventually, like, get over it? After enough people have renounced it, it's like, okay, got it.
Yeah, the renouncing message is out there. That's a good question. Like, it's interesting, and I'm curious to know how many other Catholics feel like they have to renounce it. I think that, one of the weird things I did on this issue of denounce, because people always ask me about, do Muslims denounce terrorism? And I feel like it's, one of those questions I'm sort of glad, even though it might feel sort of like culturally insensitive because, like, obviously, you know what I mean? Obviously we denounce terrorism, oh my God. So there's like that aspect of it. But I'm glad that they ask it because that's like a legitimate question, because what's happening in parts of the country where conservative talk radio is really big or where Fox News is really big or where there's a lack of civic engagement, there's a lot of people who are not getting any kind of competing message. Like, all they're getting are the dusty dudes in the desert and the floating ladies and uranium, right? So if that's all you're hearing, like, it's natural for you to think that people that Muslims don't denounce terrorism. You're not getting any kind of counter message. And then you're watching prestige cable like Homeland, and then you're continuing to get the same message, you know? And these are like our best shows. These are our best shows. So the thing I did on that front is I launched something called thedailydenouncer.com. It's like a website that denounces terrorism every day of the week but takes the weekends off. And it's single panel cartoons, you know, and we're in our early stages, so it's you know, there's a handful of cartoons up. It's not populated with and if you are in the drawing way, please hit me up. We're always looking for more artists to work with. And there are a lot of jokes. Like, for example, the first one that we put up is just a Muslim woman, and she's in an office setting, and she walks up to a printer, and she says, "Oh, I denounce terrorism. I also denounce when people never fill the paper tray." And so it's kind of a website that denounces terrorism while recognizing that it is ridiculous that we have to constantly denounce terrorism. Like, when do you stop? And so my feeling was just like, well, I could always just point people to this website, which is maybe ridiculous, but it, you know, it felt better than nothing. Are there any other questions? No? Jeez. Well, I mean, what do we do in this situation? Oh, yeah. Okay, here we go. Thank you for boldly going where only one lady has gone.
Hello. I'm Edham. I'm with NIAC. So I haven't read your book yet, but I'm very excited to do so. I was wondering what the reaction of the Muslim community has been, because you're obviously very outspoken and we all love you, but I'm just curious, growing up myself as an Iranian-American-Muslim woman, it hasn't always been easy for me, so I'm just curious what your perspective was on that.
Yeah, I mean, I started doing comedy, and I was kind of in this New York City bubble, and I didn't realize, and I'm by no means more risque or edgy or than any other comedian in New York City. Like, I'm very run of the mill there in terms of like the links I will go. But I think when you add this like Iranian Muslim layer onto it, it suddenly I become like, oh, you know, and it's like, why does that happen? So I think that early on, I didn't know that there might be any opposition to what I did. I just thought it was whatever, you know. I remember doing my first out of town gig in Chicago, and there was a huge Muslim population there, and I didn't know. I just thought I was going to do some gig, and it was crickets and tumbleweed. I mean, they hated me, and I was like doing, you know, none of the jokes I did tonight, but like similar things where I might talk about dating or whatever, and maybe use a crass word here or there, you know, and they were very offended. And then my experience had been for a few years there that I was just generally offensive to conservative Muslims, but also offensive to conservative Jews and conservative Christians, whatever. I get like a wide array of hate mail. It's cool. Because I brought this up and the Muslims are coming, and then and from our very, very small corner of the world, tried to like show the back mirror, what is the word, but anyways, show the Muslim community like what that feels like when you don't have the support of your own people, and one of the chapters in the book is actually my own people don't like me very much, and I think since that has happened, actually I've gotten so much more support from people that normally would have been very offended by my work, because they think she is a voice. We might not like that voice. And I think I think there has to be this kind of like guinea pig generation, which you and I are a part of, to make that kind of transition happen. Thank you for that question. Was there any other questions? Oh, yeah. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for making me laugh. That was wonderful. And I think good. You are doing a wonderful thing for society. Keep going.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
That's very nice.
It's happening. So I've lived in the South before. How did they handle you? How did it play out in Alabama and Mississippi?
Yeah. Well, you know what's funny is I just did Columbia, South Carolina, and I didn't know what to expect, whatever, but it's crazy because I was on the cover of their weekly newspaper. I was in all. I was on all of their radio stations. I was on two of their news channels. Like it was. It was just. I carpet bombed South Carolina, and it was. And I was like, why is am I getting so? I mean, it's like, you know, you go into a town as a comedian, you get a little press. It's cool, whatever. But this was like an extreme amount of press for one appearance, and every reporter kept saying like, you're the first Muslim comedian that's ever come through these parts, you know. And I was like, that's interesting, and now it makes sense why I'm getting so much attention. But it's also really sad, and like, you know, they just generally don't get very many like ethnic minorities going through Columbia, South Carolina, and they, I think, also because I'm not terribly PC, I think that's one of the things that like me and like the Tea Party have in common. You know what I mean? And I'm fine with that. Whatever bridge I can build, I will build that bridge. And so I think that part of the thing that they like is that, you know, and also I think I shit on myself like more than anything. So I think people, one of the lessons in how to make white people laugh, guys, and take a dump on yourself. And so I think that has had, you know, that has ingratiated me with people. But I think, you know, I also, you know, when I've been in the South, like doing street actions and setting up an Ask a Muslim booth and people can come ask questions and that kind of weird thing, I think also I benefit from being like a short lady who dresses like a cartoon character. So, you know, because I don't feel like anyone is particularly threatened. And so it makes the task of the entry point a little bit easier because they're like, what is she going to do? And then also half the time I'm like I'm plying people with pastries and like random candy and stuff. It's just fascinating to see how many strangers will accept your pastries. You know, because you're taught as a child not to do that. And so nobody learned that lesson, by the way. Literally, you can keep teaching that to your children. They're not going to do it. So I think, and I've actually had some really wonderful, some of my best shows, like one of my best ever shows was in Birmingham, Alabama. I had a really great time. And I think part of it is because they get neglected when it comes to cultural products, and people don't necessarily go through those parts. It does not have the same kind of cultural currency, and so when people do come in, they're very grateful and they're very happy to be, you know, and they're very hospitable. And so I, you know, sure, I've gotten like the hate mail and the stuff like that from people when I come to their town or whatever, and sure, I've gotten protests. I was protested once in Washington State, and this was like in the where like Twilight is filmed, part of Washington State or whatever. So there was vampires, but I there was a protest because they were like, "Don't go see this show. She's gonna convert you to Islam." Wouldn't know the first thing, to be honest. And so sometimes that stuff happens. But I'd say by and large, like Americans like want to meet people. They're thirsty for meeting each other. Oh, there's one more. Here we go.
Okay. Hi. I don't know. It is on. Okay, sorry. So I wanted to ask, because you're talking about the comedy you've done in the U.S. and parts like the South and whatnot, but have you ever thought about, or have you already done, and I don't know this, gone international? Or what is, has there been a different reaction from like an outside the U.S. perspective to your comedy?
You know, I performed only in the UK, which I feel like doesn't count. Although, you know, they have like maybe a more intense, divide in a larger Muslim population over there. And so, I performed at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, and I performed in London a few times. And I would say, you know, they're really like, they read and they like, you know, and then they also, they like know about the news, you know, and so They're so like into anything that's like considered kind of political comedy or whatever. They're really into it. So I've actually had some really good experiences performing in the UK. I think it would be really interesting to just to perform in, I don't know, Greece or something, but Germany, where there's some real like real riffs. It'd be interesting to see what that experience is like. But I haven't ventured yet. And the part of it is we have so much to do here and I feel like if I can turn Mississippi, then I'll, I just use that as a random example. There are probably people in D.C. that need turning as well. I got to get on the road. There's one more. Here we go. And I guess we can make this the last question.
Hi, I'm Sahar. As an Iranian-American woman with Iranian parents who are here, oh. Roya and Ali, I was wondering, how do you deal with your parents?
I'm so sorry that you had to watch this with your parents. It's funny because I've been, I grew up in Southern California, but I've been living in New York City for a very long time. And because of that, I've been able to separate the stand up from my parents very easily. And whenever they would come visit New York, I would not, I would just be like, I got a thing, you guys do your thing, go see a Broadway show, whatever. And so I managed to kind of really shield them from the reality of my stand-up, which I think for any parent is traumatizing. For me too, like, I don't want to fucking go and talk about my vagina in front of my dad, or your dad for that matter. But that's what happens sometimes in my stand-up. I can't help it. So anyway, it came to a point where they were coming to see the Los Angeles premiere of my last film, The Muslims Were Coming, and they invited all of their Iranian friends. I mean, nightmare. And I said to them before the screening, and this is one of those affairs that I couldn't not invite them to. That would have been weird. So I said to them, listen, you invited a bunch of your Iranian friends, like, that's nice, but they might find what I do very shameful, and I just want you to remember that this isn't for them, and just like it's funny for mainstream Americans, but not your friends. And and it was the perfect kind of environment for them to see that film, in which there's a lot of stand-up and all that stuff, because it was 400 people, and it was sold out, and everyone was laughing, and then everyone came up to them afterwards, like, you must be so proud, you must be so proud, to the point where they were like, I guess we are proud, yes, we are proud, and... I had sensed that I was a disappointment to them in some ways for going into the arts, because I heard them say things such as, she is a disappointment to us for going into the arts. And so I knew that there was an issue there, but I think to hear the validation of the crowd kind of turn them around. And then one day my dad had said to me, I said, I can't come home for Christmas because I can't afford the plane ticket, Muslim Christmas. And he said, we'll buy you a plane ticket. And I said, thank you. And I got really sad. And I was like, I'm really sorry that I haven't gotten to the point yet in my career where I can just afford shit, And he said, he's like, no, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. You're like a scientist. And scientists work on things their entire lives to cure cancer or to find some kind of discovery. And they might not even see it before they die. And then later, the work that they have done gets built upon, and then that, you know, later on someone discovers cancer because of the work they did. And so that's what you're doing. You're like, you're doing this work, and it's important, and but you may never make money from it. And I was like, thank you. I was like, well, that, you know, and I had never realized that he felt that way. And I never gave him credit for feeling that way. And I think one of the things that my parent, you know, that my parents, they came to this country and they gave me, and it's not like they wanted, you know, they had all these dreams for themselves. They wanted to be, my dad wanted to be an artist. My mom wanted to be an opera singer. And guess what? They didn't get to do that shit. They didn't get to do that shit because they had to have real jobs and they had kids and they had to keep everybody alive. And so when it was my turn to like make my own choices in life, they never stood in my way. And so I think the way you deal with your parents is, I hope, please don't prove me wrong, but give them more credit because they're on your side.
I give them a lot of credit.